Yes, Your Honor.
Yes, Your Honor. Next case we'll call is State versus Brittany R. Pilkington, CR 15080225. The defendant is present with her counsel, Court Goddardam, Mark Triplett, Tina McFall. The state is here with the County Prosecutor Eric Stewart and a senior Assistant Attorney General Dan Caceres. Counsel advised the court that a plea agreement has been reached. Counsel, want to put the terms of that agreement on the record, please?
Yes, Your Honor. As outlined in the plea petition, Your Honor, the state has filed a bill of information outlining three charges. The defendant will enter a plea of guilty to the charge of involuntary manslaughter in count one, which is a felony of the first degree, murder in count two, and murder in count three, all in the bill of information. Consideration of these pleas, the state will move to dismiss the indictment in this case, and the defendant will no longer be charged with the three counts of aggravated murder with death penalty specifications. And the state will prosecute no other charges arising from the facts and circumstances leading to the original indictment. The parties have entered a joint sentencing agreement and will recommend to the court that she receive a sentence of 7 years in prison for count one, involuntary manslaughter, an indeterminate sentence of 15 years to life in prison for count two, murder, and an indeterminate sentence of 15 years to life in prison for count three, murder, with those sentences all to be served consecutively. Also, recognition that she will receive jail time credit of 1,555 days as of today's date, November 19th, 2019. And the parties agree that imposition of court costs and other financial sanctions will be waived in this case.
There would be 5 years post-release control under count one, correct?
That is correct.
And parole for life under counts two and three.
That's correct, Judge.
Your Honor, I believe the parole is a term of 5 years to life.
5 years to life?
Minimum five.
Thank you. Any other additions or corrections to the plea agreement?
No, Your Honor, that sets forth the agreement of the parties.
Okay. And the bill of information has been filed and copy furnished to counsel?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes, Your Honor.
Would the counsel please present the waiver of grand jury to the defendant for her signature? Tom, bring that up to the...
May I approach?
You may. Ms. Pilkington, you understand that a felony case can only begin with an indictment by the grand jury, and as part of this plea agreement, you're agreeing to waive the grand jury as to the new charges that are being filed by bill of information.
Yes, Your Honor.
And you have signed this waiver here today, is that correct?
Yes.
Has a plea petition been completed?
Yes, it has.
It has, Your Honor.
Would you present that to the defendant for her signature, please?
Oops.
Mr. Stewart, you examined the plea petition as well?
Yes, Your Honor.
And one other form we've discussed is the violent offender database information. You'd have the defendant sign that as well.
One moment, Your Honor.
See where you're supposed to sign?
Yeah. Your Honor, while Ms. Pilkington signs the notice, for the record, we did file a motion under seal objecting to the imposition of this reporting requirement as unduly retroactive. We would stand on that. Ms. Pilkington understands that signing it does not mean she agrees with that, but she will comply with the duties unless a higher court says otherwise.
Very good. If you bring that forward or give it to the bailiff. Ms. Pilkington, I'm going to go over some of the same materials that was in the petition to enter a plea. If at any time you don't understand my questions and you want to stop and talk to your attorneys or ask me a question, please feel free to do so. Understand?
Yes.
Before I can accept your plea of guilty to the charges in the bill of information, I must advise you of your rights and ask questions to determine that this plea is being made voluntarily, knowingly, and intelligently by you. You have had a chance to go over the plea petition with your attorneys?
Yes, I have.
And you've signed it here voluntarily, is that correct?
Yes.
You are a citizen of the United States?
Yes, I am.
Other than the plea agreement, has anybody promised you anything to get you to enter this plea?
No.
Has anybody threatened you in any way?
No.
Now, it's been a long time that you've been in jail and you've had these attorneys for 4 years. Are you satisfied with the advice that they have given you?
Yes, I am.
You have confidence in them?
Yes.
Today, are you in good health mentally and physically?
Yes, I am.
Are you now under the influence of drugs or alcohol?
No, Your Honor.
What is your age?
27.
And how much education did you complete?
High school diploma.
And you read and write well, is that correct?
Yes.
The next thing we're going to do is discuss the nature of the charges, and we'll take these one by one and ask the prosecutor to read into the record count one.
Count one reads, on or about the 22nd day of July, 2014, the county of Logan aforesaid, The above-named Brittany Renee Pilkington did cause the death of Niall Mason Pilkington, date of birth April 11, 2014. And such death was the proximate result of Brittany Renee Pilkington committing or attempting to commit the felony offense of child endangering in violation of Revised Code 2919.22, to wit, no person who is the parent of a child under 18 years of age shall create a substantial risk to the health or safety of the child by recklessly violating a duty of care, protection, or support, and the violation resulted in serious physical harm to the child involved. Violation of Ohio Revised Code 2903.04A and 2903.04C, involuntary manslaughter, a felony of the first degree.
That charge is under section 2903.04, which provides that no person shall cause the death of another or the unlawful termination of another's pregnancy as an approximate result of the offender's committing or attempting to commit a felony. And the felony involved is endangering children. Do you understand the nature of this offense?
Yes.
It is a felony of the first degree, punishable by a maximum prison sentence of 11 years. It carries with it a mandatory post-release control of 5 years after your prison sentence. There is a presumption in favor of prison as opposed to community control. Go ahead then, Mr. Stewart, and read count two.
Count two reads, on or about the sixth day of April, 2015, the county of Logan aforesaid, the above-named Brittany Renee Pilkington did purposely cause the death of Gavin Pilkington, date of birth June 12, 2010, in violation of Ohio Revised Code section 2903.02A, murder and unclassified felony.
That section 2903.02 provides that no person shall purposely cause the death of another or an unlawful termination of another's pregnancy. Do you understand the nature of that offense?
Yes.
It is an unclassified felony carrying a sentence of 15 years to life. Please read count three, Mr. Stewart.
On or about the 18th day of August, 2015, the county of Logan aforesaid, the above-named Brittany Renee Pilkington did purposely cause the death of Noah Pilkington, date of birth May 14th, 2015, violation of Ohio Revised Code section 2903.02, murder and unclassified felony.
And again, that is under section 2903.02, which provides that no person shall purposely cause the death of another or unlawful termination of another's pregnancy. You understand the nature of that offense?
Yes.
And that too carries with it a life, a 15-year to life sentence. That the attorneys went over with you in your petition all the rights that you are giving up, specifically by pleading guilty. There is no trial. The trial would be a jury trial where your attorneys would have a right to select the jury along with the prosecutor. By pleading guilty, you're giving up this right to a speedy public jury trial. Your right at that trial to confront the witnesses against you. You have a right to subpoena witnesses who could testify in your defense. You have a right to require the state to prove its case beyond a reasonable doubt. At trial, you have a right to testify. You can also choose not to take the stand in which case the prosecutor can't comment on that fact to the jury. Do you understand these rights?
Yes.
And you understand by pleading guilty to these charges, you're giving up your right to trial and all the rights associated with it?
Yes.
The counsel, are there any other terms or conditions of this plea that we have not discussed to date?
No, Your Honor.
No, Your Honor.
The these offenses are not counts 2 and 3 are not probationable. Count 1, there is a presumption in favor of prison. A plea of guilty is a complete admission of your guilt and waives the rights that we've discussed above. Mr. Stewart and Mr. Caceres, will you give a statement of facts as to what the state's evidence would be as to these three charges? Let's do them one at a time.
Okay. Your Honor, we have an agreed statement of facts prepared by both parties. Count 1, the parties agree that in the early morning hours of July 22, 2014, at 868 East Sandusky Avenue, apartment 215, Bell Fountain, Ohio, Logan County, Brittany Renee Pilkington did cause the death of Niall Mason Pilkington, whose date of birth is April 11, 2014, as a proximate result of Brittany Renee Pilkington committing or attempting to commit the felony offense of child endangering contrary to revised code 2929.22. The offense of child endangering is defined as no person who is the parent of a child under 18 years of age shall create a substantial risk to the health or safety of the child by recklessly violating a duty of care, protection, or support, and the violation resulted in serious physical harm to the child in violation of revised code 2903.04 ANC, involuntary manslaughter, a felony of the first degree.
Do you have any questions about the statement the prosecutor just made as to count 1?
No.
You tell me you're guilty, you're admitting the truth of that statement, understood?
Yes.
How do you plead to count 1 involuntary manslaughter?
Guilty.
You want to make a statement as to count 2?
Count 2, the parties agreed that in the early morning hours of April 6, 2015, at 868 East Sandusky Avenue, apartment 215, Bell Fountain, Ohio, Logan County, Brittany Renee Pilkington would purposely cause the death of Gavin Pilkington, date of birth June 12, 2010, in violation of revised code 2903.02A, 2903.02D, and 2929.02B, this offense being murder and unclassified felony.
Did you hear the statement as to count 2?
Yes.
Do you have any questions about what the prosecutor just said as to count 2?
No.
Again, if you tell me you're guilty, you're admitting the truth of that statement, understood?
Yes.
How do you plead to count 2?
Guilty.
Go ahead and make a statement as to count 3, Mr. Stewart.
Count 3, the parties agreed that in the early morning hours of August 18th, 2015, at 868 East Sandusky Avenue, apartment 215, Bell Fountain, Ohio, Logan County, Brittany Renee Pilkington did purposely cause the death of Noah Pilkington, date of birth May 14th, 2015, in violation of revised code section 2903.02A, 2903.02D, 2929.02B, this offense being murder and unclassified felony.
Did you hear the statement of the prosecutor regarding count 3?
Yes.
Do you have any questions as to count 3?
No.
Again, if you tell me that you're guilty, you're admitting the truth of that statement, understood?
Yes.
And how do you plead then as to count 3?
Guilty.
Based upon the plea petition, based upon the defendant's answers here in open court, the court finds that these pleas are being made knowingly, voluntarily, and intelligently. The court accepts the same and enters findings of guilt as to all three charges contained in the bill of information. Their motion as to the original indictment.
Your Honor, the state moves to dismiss the original indictment.
That motion is granted. counsel wish to have a pre-sentence investigation?
Waive PSI, Your Honor.
You wish to make a statement, Mr. Goddardam, before the court passes sentence?
I do. First and foremost, I ask the court to accept the joint recommendation of the parties. As the court is aware, this case has been ongoing over 4 years properly because death is different. And there have been so many issues in this case in my 31 years, and I'm not sure I've seen a case this complex, this complicated. At the end of the day, we were able to reach a joint recommendation that I think is reasonable to all sides. I ask the court to, as a matter of housekeeping, suspend any fines and costs and grant 1,555 days of jail time credit. Your Honor, what I'm about to say is not an attempt to minimize the crimes that our client has just pled guilty to. She understands the seriousness of this, she understands what occurred, and by pleading guilty today, she's accepting responsibility for her actions. But I ask you to just imagine, in your first year of life, being poisoned by lead. I ask you to imagine being developmentally delayed, but neither your parents, the schools, social services, or any other agencies helped you. Imagine then your mother bringing a monster into your life. Imagine someone who starts grooming you at age 9. You have lead poisoning, you have sleep apnea, you're neglected, you're physically abused. And now imagine you're sexually abused. Sexual abuse that would repeat itself hundreds of times in her young life. And there were repeated signs of this. But imagine no adults around you came to your aid. Imagine you didn't get trauma-informed treatment, as we've heard Dr. Fradkin in a previous hearing testify to. Imagine the school's not helping you. Children's services. Doctors. The records bear this all out. And if we had a trial on this matter, all of that would have been placed in trial. At the very least, in a penalty phase, if we got there. Imagine being so traumatized that your mind dissociates and goes to another place to escape the abuse. Whether it's from lead poisoning, sleep apnea, trauma, developmental delays, Brittany's brain is broken. She's irreparably damaged. Dr. Jeff Madden, the neuropsychologist, diagnosed it first, and he was spot on. He did a battery of neuropsychological tests, and he opined that there was problems in the right frontal lobe of Brittany's brain. Now, he's not a medical doctor, so he couldn't give the final piece of that puzzle. The court allowed us to pursue this matter because of how important it is in determining the appropriate penalty and determining whether the death penalty is appropriate under these circumstances. Now Dr. Madden's work has been confirmed by Dr. Newberg and the PET scan that was run on Rip Pilkington's brain. The PET scan confirms brain damage, and I will step back for a minute. We filed a sentencing memorandum today. That anybody who has any doubts about anything I'm saying, or about the trauma that Brittany Pilkington has endured in her life, read it. There's reports from all our experts in there. There's a summary of the PET scan in there. It leaves no doubt whatsoever. The PET scan confirmed brain damage, particularly in the right frontal lobe. It was worse than we thought. It affects executive functioning. It's associated with abnormalities in cognitive and emotional processing, memory problems, emotional dysregulation, concentration, anxiety, all caused likely by lead poisoning, congenital or developmental problems, or trauma. We had an intellectual disability hearing scheduled for yesterday. Given the PET scan findings, Dr. Kahn's report, and all the other reports, in my view, there was a 100% chance this court would have been compelled to find Brittany intellectually disabled. However, when given a structured environment, Brittany Pilkington can do well. In the 4 years that she's been in jail, she's never been in trouble. She's a model inmate. And with all the programs, psychological services, education, Brittany Pilkington can thrive at ORW, the Ohio Reformatory for Women. Sadly, she was safer and living a better life in jail than she was on the outside. The perfect storm that led to her three children's deaths will never be present again. Brittany, as you will hear the statement that will be read briefly, misses deeply her daughter and her three boys. But imagine almost every day of your life, the first 23 years of her life before she was incarcerated, having to deal with the effects of lead and untold trauma to your body and mind, abuse, neglect, and abandonment. Brittany Pilkington didn't have to imagine that, Connor. She had to live that. And that's why we're here today. So to this court, to the prosecution, to the parole board, and to society, no human being should suffer like she suffered. It does not excuse her conduct, but by God it does explain. I hope one day she will be free, and she deserves to be free. She will serve her time, and she will serve it well. Brittany Pilkington was dealt a bad hand of cards, and unfortunately, that's why we're here today. I ask the court to impose the joint recommendation of the sentence, allow Ms. Pilkington to move on with her life as best as she possibly can. And, Your Honor, at the appropriate time, because of the trauma, because of what she's been through, I don't think Brittany can possibly stand up and offer a statement. It doesn't mean she doesn't have the extreme feelings of remorse, pain that she's caused everyone. She knows that. She gets that. But it takes time. It took us quite a bit of time. And fortunately, the court was responsive to our request. We used several psychologists, a trauma psychologist, a neuropsychologist, a geneticist. We needed all of these folks to try to uncoil and unravel what was going on and what has gone on. So again, at the appropriate time, I believe Brittany's statement in her words will be read by Ms. Fall. But again, Your Honor, this is a reasonable resolution to a very difficult set of circumstances for everybody around. I'm not minimizing anything why we're here today at all. But I've never seen in 31 years somebody so broken and so abused and so traumatized. And that has to account for something. The death penalty is in no way, shape, or form appropriate in this case. And this resolution shows that. Thank you.
Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Your Honor. First, for the record, I'd like to acknowledge that Sam's in White with Marcy Long. Those that are related to the victims in this case have all been notified of this hearing and given an opportunity to come and present our statements to the court. Pursuant to the plea agreement, as Mr. Goddard stated, the state recommends indefinite sentence, life in prison on each murder count, and 7 years in prison on the involuntary manslaughter count, all run consecutive, two life sentences plus 7 years. I can't even really pretend to speak on behalf of the three boys that lost their lives. I don't know what they would want me to say to their mother. Their lives have been cut short, way too short. Many lost opportunities. Many lost opportunities for love in this life. Nia was only 3 months old. Gavin was almost 5. And Noah was almost 3 months. Ava lost 3 of her brothers. Consecutive sentences are merited in this case because this was a course of conduct The harm was so great and so unusual that no city prison term can adequately reflect the seriousness of what has been done ever in Pilkington. Present for today are Hodge and Laura Hager. They were foster parents to Noah immediately before Noah died. During that period of time, they became very attached to Noah and Haley, and they were absolutely devastated by the loss of Noah. They submitted an impact statement for the court to consider. Also present in court is Judy Grimes and her husband Dave Grimes. Judy Grimes is now Haley's caretaker. She reports, tells me that Haley is doing well, she's thriving, in mom's school and extracurricular activities. Judy Grimes has prepared a short statement on behalf of the family, and Dave Grimes, her husband, would like to read that statement.
Proceed.
Your Honor, I would like to thank you for giving our family an opportunity to express how selfish this year's decision of life has affected the mind of the individual. Growing up with siblings is something you have to experience to be able to explain. The ups and downs of having someone to express your feelings, ideas, fears, and as well as put it with some of the best parts. From the traumatic experience of losing your first student, really disappointing. Only to have someone knocking on to hold in your hand when you are afraid or encourage you to do something when you are never willing. These are the things you take for granted or complain about as you grow older. But would not trade one experience for another. Haley's chance. Make these memories. Was a race. And not one selfish act of free. The decision affects her daily life. Every day. She questions what if Gavin, Noah, or not would like this help, this sport. Going skating, dancing, the song, or food. When she is scared, she always talks to herself and says her brothers are with her. So she can. Whether it is riding home because of being alone in the dark or on the camp. Recently, when her fish died, she asked if she was going to be a bad mom when she grows up. Even though she had a little compassion love and her peace of earthness, these are questions she will not only be asked at this age, but for the rest of her life. She's had to deal with a lifetime of heartache, fear, and loss because of one person. One person who is supposed to keep her children safe from harm, betrayed her children, family, faith, and community. Brittany has robbed us all of a chance to watch three beautiful boys grow up tonight. But robbed Haley most. And also, in closing, I'd like to ask, Your Honor, could you ever imagine the last thing you saw in this world was your mother as she smothered you in death? Thank you.
Your Honor, the state asked the court to impose the jointly recommended sentence, consecutive sentences warranted to meet statutory factors.
Detective Sagers is here. You want to ask him if he has any?
Detective Sagers, what do you need to say?
Paul, you want to read the defendant's statement then?
I do, Your Honor. Ask for permission to read it from a seated position next to him.
You may.
Brittany Pilkington takes responsibility for the deaths of her children by and through her plea today. She's unable to give her own statement at this time because she's so emotionally affected by what's going on around her. But she asks that this court hear her through counsel. She wants the court to know that she loves and misses all of her children, and she grieves for them every day. Brittany's has had a difficult time understanding how her life turned out the way it did. Over the multiple court hearings in the years that have gone by, Brittany has learned that there were people in her life that suspected the sexual abuse that she was enduring, and that they were brave enough to report it to Children's Services. She wants to thank them all. Her brother Brandon, her uncle Jeff Skaggs, the ER doctor that treated her, members of the prosecutor's office, and her teacher for reporting their suspicions. She wishes that she had been removed from her home as a child and that her life could have been different as a result. As far back as Brittany can remember, she has lived life with debilitating fear, anxiety, and terror on a daily basis. She thought it was because she lived with Joe Pilkington since the age of 8 and because of all the abuse she endured, and she was afraid of him. It wasn't until she was evaluated by Dr. Jeffrey Madden, Dr. Kratkin, Dr. Bergman, and Dr. Kahn that she began to understand that her brain is damaged in an area that might cause the anxiety, the fear, and the terror she feels. She had no idea that that was even possible. She wants to especially thank Dr. Madden for ordering the PET scan that revealed the specific areas of her brain that are damaged, so that maybe she can get the proper treatment and rehabilitation that she needs. She also wants to thank the jailers for their protection and kindnesses over the last 4 years, especially Ms. Kim and Ms. Diamond, the inmates that have also extended their protection and kindnesses to her over the years. And she wants to thank the nurses at the jail that were finally successful in getting medication for her anxiety and depression. Brittany sincerely hopes that the information gathered in her case can and will help other sexually abused children in the future and to help them to receive help early. Brittany wants to tell her mother and her father that she forgives them for any shortcomings that they may have had as parents when they failed to protect her from Joe Pilkington, because she now believes that no one could have under the circumstances. He was just too good at manipulating. Brittany takes responsibility for the death of the children by pleading guilty to these charges today and sincerely loves, misses, and grieves the loss of each one of them. She hopes that life will be kinder to her daughter and that someday Haley may be able to forgive her. Thank you.
Defendant, stand. Is there anything you want to tell the court before the court passes sentence?
No.
As to count one, the involuntary manslaughter of the death of Nile, the court, pursuant to the plea agreement, imposes a seven-year sentence. As to count two, murder and the death of Gavin, the court imposes a 15 years to life. As to count three, the death of Noah, the court imposes the same 15 years to life. The court finds that this is a case where consecutive sentences are permitted, even demanded by the law, that the court finds its consecutive sentences are necessary to protect the public from future crime and to punish the offender. And the consecutive sentences are not disproportionate to the seriousness of the offender's conduct and the danger the offender imposes to the public. The court also finds that at least two of the multiple offenses were committed as part of one or more courses of conduct, and the harm caused by two or more of the multiple offenses so committed was so great and unusual that no single prison term for any of the offenses committed as part of the course of conduct adequately reflects the seriousness of the offender's conduct. In addition to the, so the net result is that the sentence of the court is 37 years minimum to life. That the parties are in agreement that the defendant has spent 1,555 days in jail as of today's date, November 19, 2019. If you were granted parole, you would be on post-release control for a mandatory 5 years. After your release from prison, you will be on a period of post-release control for 5 years following your release from prison. If you violate a post-release control sanction imposed upon you, any one or more of the following may result. The parole board may impose a more restrictive post-release control sanction upon you. Two, the parole board may increase the duration of the post-release control subject to a specified maximum, and that maximum is 8 years. Three, the more restrictive sanction that the parole board may impose may consist of a prison term, provided that the prison term cannot exceed 9 months, and the maximum cumulative prison term so imposed for all violations during the period of post-release control cannot exceed one half of the stated prison term originally imposed upon you. And finally, if the violation of the sanction is a felony, you may be prosecuted for the felony. And in addition to any sentence it imposes on you for the new felony, the court may impose a prison term subject to a specified maximum, that maximum being the greater of 1 year or the time left on your 5 years post-release control. That's as to count one. As to count two and three, you will be on a parole that could extend for your life. The if you are released for a period of 10 years, you may have a legal obligation to enroll in the violent offender database and renew that enrollment once a year. And if you fail to do so, that could constitute a violation of the terms of your post-release control or your parole, plus constitute a separate fifth-degree felony. Court waives the court cost. Counsel, is there anything the court has not addressed?
No, Your Honor.
No, Your Honor. The court is in recess. The defendant is remanded to the custody of the sheriff to carry out the sentence.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.